In our last foray into the wild nothing of space, we learned that the governments of the US and USSR had not been shy about using space to help end the world. Literal nuclear explosions have lit up our skies already, creating auroras, scrambling radio waves, and scaring the crap out of preppers with their electromagnetic consequences. Thanks to the high-altitude tests of the 50s and 60s, every capable superpower now likely has missiles pointed toward the heavens, ready to trash every solitary satellite in the atmosphere. But is that really war in space? I mean, it's just the atmosphere after all. Where are the orbital battle stations? Where are the kinetic energy weapons? Where are the frickin' lasers? Well, in the far future of 1983, one man, one administration, one collective dream promised to manifest the world of tomorrow in the lofty heights of space. You want lasers? You got it. You want orbital weapons? How about hundreds of them, and enough kinetic interceptors to secure the safety of the world for generations, all by the year 2000. Let's not waste any time. It's Star Wars.
I call upon the scientific community in our country, those who gave us nuclear weapons, to turn their great talents now to the cause of mankind and world peace, to give us the means of rendering these nuclear weapons impotent and obsolete.
The cause of defensive weapons was never abandoned by a small group of scientists, congressional and military leaders. They believed defensive weapons could recapture American supremacy.
Our only purpose is to search for ways to reduce the danger of nuclear war.
Before we get to the space lasers, we have to establish some backstory first. You see, Reagan's Star Wars was not just some harebrained idea to build lasers just because bullets are too old school. No, the Strategic Defense Initiative, as it is officially known, had one overarching goal since its inception: strategic missile defense. The whole concept was born immediately after the dawn of ballistic missiles, way back in the early 40s. I talked in part one about Wernher von Braun and the V-2 rocket, the cataclysmic granddaddy of space exploration and convenient nuclear apocalypse alike. And unsurprisingly, the Nazi rocket got a lot of people thinking, how do you stop what is essentially a bullet full of high explosives?
I hate when people underestimate my fastness. I'm fast. I'm so fast, you couldn't even comprehend how fast I am.
The first and most obvious ideas involved more missiles, pointed precariously at the incoming payloads. But this idea was likened by many to trying to hit a bullet with another bullet. Now, not to blow the ending here, but that is actually something that we can do today with some level of consistency. But back in the 50s and 60s, it was pretty much impossible. Early efforts like Project Wizard ran into detection problems and limited radar range, meaning that they couldn't even see the missile in time to stop it. But even when technology made early warning possible, there was little that could be done, especially when the Russians demonstrated their ability to put rockets in space. I won't get into specifics here because I already did that in part one, but suffice it to say, the most obvious path forward was to fight nukes with nukes. Skipping past force fields and Project Argus, the real hope for mankind was nuclear-tipped interceptors. This makes sense because a huge nuclear blast could provide a net wide enough to catch an incoming ICBM. Easy enough, right? Well, not really. The anti-ballistic missile systems, or ABM as I'll be saying for the rest of the video, still needed to be more accurate than your typical ICBM, and they needed to be armed, launched, and aimed precisely at a moment's notice. And that wasn't going to be cheap back then.
Oh, you almost had it. You've got to be quicker than that.
Not to mention, citizens didn't like the idea of trading nuke for nuke, especially when the whole affair would ostensibly take place over their actual heads. Even if it made sense pound for pound, telling the public that less of you will die never tends to go over well.
But back at the war room, they believe you can win a nuclear war. There can be acceptable losses.
With both the high price tag and real potential for collateral damage in mind, the defense planners of the day surmised that it made more sense to just build more ICBMs to point at Russia rather than at our own skies. In fact, it turns out the Soviets agreed with that sentiment, at least as far as the international community was concerned. In 1972, the US entered a treaty with the USSR that limited anti-ballistic missile systems within either country. Specifically, both nations were allowed two ABM complexes with 100 missiles in each. The reason for this is quite simple. If both countries were sprinting towards secure, reliable ABM, it would force both of them to develop better and more numerous offensive arms in response. If your enemy gets armor, you get armor-piercing weapons. If that whole idea seems bizarre to you, you're not alone. Many hardliners in US defense felt the whole affair was rather defeatist. Why should we stop trying to save American lives from the greatest possible threat? But on the other hand, you could probably see the reasoning behind the ABM treaty. Either one side does amazingly and gains the all-coveted first strike capability with protection, or both sides continue to develop better and better weapons, bringing us all even closer to the brink. Either way, it was a tough problem, and it wouldn't be long before dissidents appeared in the US defense community, and these dissidents were packing some crazy ideas. The idea of using lasers for combat purposes was not born of science fiction alone. The first functioning laser was developed in 1960, and it took only until the 1970s before military minds began to explore the fantastical possibilities of laser weapons.
A giant death ray? A military application?
Yeah.
The first inklings of a functioning ABM laser came from a few different concurrent sources. One of the biggest proponents of the idea was a senator named Malcolm Wallop, a future major supporter of SDI. Wallop teamed up with another think tanky type named Angelo Codavia, and between the two of them, neither had any practical experience with lasers. But they would soon team up with someone who did, Maxwell Hunter, an engineer working for Lockheed. Hunter was a big proponent of ABM, and he reckoned lasers could do the job if they could be made powerful enough. Hunter was speculative that it could be done soon, but optimistic enough that Senator Wallop would parade the engineer around Washington, lobbying for space-based ABM. Wallop and Codavia, with Hunter's assistance, told various government committees that they could protect the US from the entirety of Russia's nuclear arsenal with merely 24 laser battle stations in space. These orbital lasers would use mirrors to focus the beam over distances as far as 3,000 miles, covering the entire globe and shielding America from Soviet ICBMs completely. They even said that they could do it by the end of the 1980s if only they got a Manhattan Project-level budget to play with.
We just need money.
But the military was not so optimistic. R&D officers in the Army and Air Force estimated that even if the project could be accomplished at all, it would take as many as 1,444 battle stations with a national debt level price tag of $1.4 trillion in 1979. This pipe dream of a proposal is rather laughable in hindsight, but it did accomplish the Herculean task of putting space lasers into the official Senate agenda and on the minds of US defense personnel, where it would stay throughout the coming decade. But Wallop and Codavia weren't the only people thinking about lasers back in the 70s. Another more lofty figure was giving some real credence to the idea, and he brought his considerable reputation and resources to bear on the subject. Edward Teller was a preeminent theoretical physicist, most known today for fathering the hydrogen bomb. He was a dyed-in-the-wool patriot and an advocate of ABM, and he was also incredibly wary of the Soviets and by all regards a very hawkish supporter of American military superiority. In 1980, scientists from Teller's laboratory were able to produce the first nuclear-powered X-ray laser during Test Dauphine, part of Operation Guardian, a series of underground shots at the Nevada test site. The Dauphine explosion was the culmination of nearly a decade of research by the Lawrence Livermore scientists, and though they had not achieved the biotech laser they were after, they had produced a potential revolution in missile defense. At least, that's what Teller thought. Before we continue, I think I need to explain a very little bit about lasers, what they are, and more importantly, for our purposes, how they're powered. Firstly, as most of us already know, laser is actually an acronym for Light Amplification by Stimulated Emission of Radiation. Essentially, a laser uses electromagnetic radiation to amplify and collimate a light source that can be focused into a beam. Lasers are used for a plethora of different scientific, military, medical, and now even consumer applications. And theoretically, if the conditions were right, you could superheat and destroy things with a laser. There are a ton of technical details that go into what makes a laser and how each one works, and even today there is a lot of R&D going into a laser development. This stuff is really complex, and there are a ton of exceptions with nearly everything I just said, and I'm no physicist. So if I don't get everything right, please let me know in the comments. Anyway, I said before that the power source for lasers was important for us, and that's because Teller and Wallop were proponents of two different styles of laser. Wallop's lasers would use chemical reactions to power their beams, while Teller's lasers would use X-rays generated from an actual nuclear explosion. So naturally, Teller's lasers would be no use in a biotech lab, but in the vast nothing of space, there'd be no one to complain about nuclear lasers. In fact, the proposed X-ray laser platform would be smaller and cheaper to produce than Wallop's chemical laser, so that was a bonus. Neither Wallop nor Teller had much luck pitching Space ABM during the Carter years, as most of the administration was against anything that might stir the pot with Russia and appear aggressive.
He's history's greatest monster!
But all of that was set to change in the forthcoming decade. A new president promised new possibilities and perhaps a real chance at the futuristic laser defenses Teller and Wallop dreamed about. So, if I haven't lost you already, I want to make something really clear right now before I get into the nitty-gritty. This video, more than any I've made previously, delves into politics. I know, I shudder at the thought and I'm cringing just saying it, but it's true. This topic is intrinsically linked to the politics of the Reagan administration and the diplomatic relationship it had with the USSR. I'm going to talk about stuff that is considered embarrassing by some to the Gipper, and I may even take a jab or two at Ronnie Reagan before it's all over. But please, understand that I take no political stance in this video essay, and my sole aim is, as always, to deliver a compelling story from history and have fun doing it. I will do my best to be fair, and I only ask that you, dear viewers, remember that no politicians ever actually cared about you anyway.
Has come. You've seen the map, we've looked at the figures, and NBC News now makes its projection for the presidency. Reagan is our projected winner. Ronald Wilson Reagan.
The election of Ronald Reagan in 1980 was one of those decade-defining moments that changed the face, outlook, and attitude of the whole country. Reagan is considered by many to be the archetypal conservative president. Strong, stoic, patriotic, and optimistic about the future of the USA and its place in the international community. Almost to a fault, depending on who you ask. Reagan promised to make America stronger, richer, and safer from its rivals in the USSR, contrasting heavily with the meek and mild-seeming Carter administration. Part of this new stance against Russia was reconsidering the various arms agreements the US had made with them in the past. And this stance was all well and good on the campaign trail, but when that same rigid rhetoric came out of the actual national mouthpiece, it made a lot of folks at home and abroad very nervous. Some felt that the Reagan administration's boldness was simply warmongering. Once elected, Reagan began the largest peacetime military buildup in American history. And in 1981, the KGB even sent out advisories to its foreign stations that the US might have been preparing to attack soon.
And I'm gonna blow that shithole camp to smithereens.
And if you listened to the speech coming out of Washington at the time, you might have believed them. Warnings of a window of vulnerability similar to what was seen during the 1930s, mingled with horror stories of drastically increased Russian arms and even rumors of Russian space weapons, all of which stirred up fears and brought the temperature to scathing levels in the early 80s. We know now that Russia did have more nukes than we did back then, and they really had researched space weapons, though with limited success. But we also know that the Soviet Union was facing some serious socioeconomic difficulties at the time, and that they were no more eager to start a nuclear war than we were, which I recognize as a ridiculous thing to say, but you get it. But as far as the Reagan administration was concerned, war was all but inevitable, and they had to do something to project strength onto Russia. In addition to the unpopular defense policies, Reagan also had to deal with a holdover problem from the previous decade, the Missile, Experimental Program, or MX. MX would later be known as the LGM-118 Peacemaker, a highly advanced ICBM for the time, capable of carrying 11 to 12 MIRVed warheads along with decoys. These missiles were the best of the best in apocalypse technology, but the Carter administration was unable to deploy them thanks to budgetary limitations, and the precarious problem of protecting the massive bases needed for the missiles.
Silent in their underground silos, These intercontinental ballistic missiles have kept America secure for two decades. Only a direct hit will penetrate the reinforced concrete which protects these Minuteman and Titan missiles from enemy warheads. But enemy ICBMs are becoming just that accurate. Their warheads are now able to destroy a significant portion of our strategic missiles in their silos. The ballistic missile's deterrent will become a thing of the past.
The MX basing problem was no less a boondoggle for the Reagan administration, with wild ideas being thrown around like putting the launch platforms on rails and scooting them around the Great Plains to avoid Russian nuclear strikes. The main problem was that these weapons were extremely powerful and extremely expensive, so they had to have some guarantee that they would survive the outbreak of war long enough to strike Russia. Every idea posited was met with resistance, and no part of a basing solution would have been cheap, so even the defense-minded government of Reagan was making no headway with the problem, and the whole affair was becoming an embarrassing quagmire for the president. Reagan's popularity was sinking in early 1983. He appeared hawkish to the general public, and his admin was unable to secure the offensive capabilities needed to protect America from Russia. Something was needed to shore up that protection, and to prove to the country and the world that Reagan was no warmonger and that peace was his number one goal. It would also help if it could protect MX in the process and garner more money for the defense budget. So it happened that not Teller nor Wallop, with their practical and not-so-practical experience, but rather a Navy admiral and an afterthought inclusion in a strategy meeting, would plant the seed of SDI and bring about the birth of Star Wars. Admiral James Watkins was an engineer by education, and he was convinced that directed energy weapons could spell the end of the offensive arms race and the abandonment of the mutually assured destruction principle. Nobody took this idea all that seriously, but when the Joint Chiefs met with the President to discuss the ongoing MX basing debacle, they included Watkins' proposal out of sheer desperation. The last of five strategic proposals to the President, Watkins' idea was the only one that leaned more on defense than aggression, and even though it had not been studied at all, it was the one Reagan shined to the most. He had found his answer to the warmongering problem, a project that was all about peace, progress, and American ingenuity. Despite resistance and utter shock from the defense community, Reagan was ready to go full sail with SDI, announcing the revolutionary policy via his famous Star Wars speech on March 23, 1983. A year later, the SDIO was established, and real taxpayer funds began to flow into the project. Reagan vowed to defend America from Russian nukes, forsaking the so-called suicide pact that was mutually assured destruction, propping up American technology as a bulwark against Soviet aggression. The Star Wars speech was met with a mixture of surprise and confusion. The defense community had basically been told that they had to use space tech to defend the whole country from Russian nukes. The diplomatic community had essentially been told that the number one bargaining chip between the two superpowers, the one thing that presumably kept us from Armageddon, was now being abandoned for science fiction dreams. But, to the American people, a strong president just told them that very soon they wouldn't have to worry about nukes anymore. And that sentiment was all Reagan wanted. Hey everybody, I am in the middle of editing this video and I realized I left something out that was kind of important. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that the name Star Wars that is often applied to SDI was of course an insult to Reagan. It was meant to sort of parallel the ridiculous ideas that were coming out of SDI with the movie series, of course. Yeah, so it's kind of important for the title of the video, and in case anybody was wondering, that is where it came from. It was a political jab towards the Reagan administration because of space lasers. And despite Reagan's promises that all SDI tech would be shared with Russia, what they heard was the U.S. is about to put all manner of weapons in space, violate the ABM treaty, and force us to spend untold millions to counter this move. This notion would become very important on the largest battlefield of the Cold War, the battlefield of diplomacy. Thanks to divine providence or stupid luck, the US and USSR never fired an official shot at each other during the decades of the Cold War. But that does not mean there was no war happening at all. The frustrating, intrigue-filled circus that is international diplomacy saw the politicking peddlers of national interest go head-to-head on everything from economic issues to the actual super-real end of human existence. So much of the drama of the Cold War was played out through speeches, treaty proposals, summit meetings, and bargaining. bargaining with nuclear weapons in everything from amount, power levels, delivery systems, and yes, the ability to destroy said weapons. It is bizarre, looking back, to imagine old men in suits nitpicking a treaty that seeks to limit the destructive power of two nations. An agreement has to necessarily involve compromise in the reaching of a mutual goal, hopefully to the benefit of both parties. But we're talking about two countries going to political war with the entirety of the world in the balance, and these talks had to happen, if for no other reason than to prove to their respective populations and to the world that neither country actually wanted a nuclear war. It's a complex picture to paint, so I won't be going too deep into diplomacy here, but I will try to outline what the general aims of a premier or president might have been. So, you want your country to prosper and make money, and you really don't want it to get annihilated in a nuclear war. You don't necessarily want the other country to be destroyed either, but you at least need to project a willingness to do it. What would drive you to that decision? Well, that tended to change by the administration or regime, but the only thing that would guarantee a nuclear response was a nuclear provocation. This idea was referred to as mutually assured destruction. Retaliation may have been the first and most plainly stated reason for keeping a nuclear arsenal, but they served another purpose too. If your opponent has aims that are contrary to your own, they will have to tippy-toe around the point, because both you and he know that any wrong step could mean his utter destruction. But of course, that's why they have their nukes too, so they can make you walk on eggshells too, even when you're only responding to what they did in the first place. Boy, it's just so hard not to blow up the world. Anyway, even though the desires of your constituents or subjects might be obvious to even the dullest of analysts, you have to make it seem like it's really hard to grant those desires. The other side is always in the way, so you need to maintain a volatile concoction of posturing, threats, and acquiescence to show onlookers that you are doing everything in your power to guarantee peace in your time.
Sorry about the Falklands, old boy.
Oh, forget it. We kind of knew they were yours.
To do this, you're going to need bargaining chips, and lots of them. Maybe you got them by building more nukes, or maybe more effective nukes. You could build more ICBMs, or maybe stealth bombers, or even SLBMs. Whatever tech you can do better and more numerously than your opponent will give you a card to play at the negotiating table and get you one step closer to maintaining the status quo.
Sometimes I wonder if what we do makes any difference at all.
I don't know. Again, this is the part where men in suits yell at each other and threaten to end the world while ostensibly wanting the same things. It's fun, right? Okay. I know that was a rather facetious and pedestrian explanation of diplomacy, and the issues both countries had with each other were obviously serious and consequential. Both powers wanted to project influence across the world to garner up more resources and shore up their stakes during a volatile time. And the process of negotiating these issues is complex and nuanced. But it certainly feels dirty when you study the various summits and treaties of the Cold War.
My God, that's crazy.
And at the end of all of this, we get to one of the best parts of SDI for the Reagan administration, the diplomatic possibilities. Yes, SDI can be cynically viewed as a gambit on the USA's part to put the Russians in a weaker position diplomatically and militarily, leaving America with a functional safety net in case the USSR felt pushed too far. After all, SDI was threatening to do the very thing that the ABM Treaty was designed to avoid, add another costly temperature-raising race to the Cold War. But Reagan's team was sure to remind Gorbachev and the Soviets that they were welcome to the SDI tech, and that the only goal of Star Wars was to preclude the need of strategic arms for good.
To give us the means of rendering these nuclear weapons impotent and obsolete.
Whether or not Reagan himself believed this was almost irrelevant, as the ABM violations and the dangerous implications of SDI was enough to make it a sticking point in Russian negotiations for years to come. The Soviets called for the demilitarization of space for the first time in 1983, as a direct response to the SDI announcement. And Gorbachev would continually make mention of his concerns with space weapons during his time negotiating with Reagan. In fact, Gorbachev was relatively acquiescent compared to his forebears, and he even offered some of the most comprehensive disarmament deals yet seen, but always with the caveat that SDI needed to be strictly limited or else ended altogether. But to Reagan, this meant giving up on a future free from nukes, so he strictly protected SDI, never allowing it to go on the table during his presidency. Even when his foreign policy experts recommended ways to use it as a bargaining chip, and even when those same experts assumed that that was why it was there all along, Reagan would not let go of Star Wars. Was this altruism, big-headedness, or perhaps malicious manipulation? Who knows? We'll talk about that later. After all of this chatter about diplomacy and the so-called power of SDI, what, if anything, did the Russians really have to fear from Reagan's ray guns? What the hell was SDI practically supposed to do? Well, I'll tell you. It was supposed to supersede and totally end the era of strategic nuclear weaponry through high-tech, space-based anti-missile technology. The Russians may have had a lot of nukes, but America had a fast-growing tech industry and the sheer will to make it happen. At least, that's what they hoped. In reality, most of the tech promised by Star Wars was strictly theoretical. For all of the worrying the Soviets did over it, SDI was incredibly far-fetched, even by today's standards. The whole idea was a big surprise to the military R&D folks, who thought the whole space laser thing was done and dusted back when Wallet proposed it in 1979. But here was Reagan, telling them that not only were lasers back on the menu, but that they would be the main course.
You know, I have one simple request. And that is to have
satellites
with frickin' laser beams attached to their heads.
The first and easiest direction would be Teller's X-ray laser, as it had already proven at least plausible in a practical sense. Following the announcement of SDI, Teller's boys began working in earnest to perfect their X-ray laser, as the original test only proved the potential viability of such a weapon. Project Excalibur promised to deliver an orbital defense platform capable of lasing multiple ICBMs at once, a marked advantage over Wallop's chemical lasers, of which hundreds upon hundreds would be needed. The basic concept was this. The module would contain a nuclear weapon set to detonate when targets came into range. Metal rods would serve as the lasing medium, guided in the direction of incoming targets by sensors that didn't yet exist. The weapon detonates, generating the necessary radiation and sending the destructive beams toward the targets, and hopefully rendering them inert before they even go back through the atmosphere. What could go wrong?
It's perfect.
Well, a lot, actually. Ignoring the fact that the tests themselves were showing mixed results, many skeptics doubted the ability of Excalibur to truly cope with a massive attack. It seemed like the only thing Russia would need to do to beat Excalibur would be to overwhelm it with more nukes. In addition, given that Excalibur was itself a satellite, it wouldn't be all that difficult for the USSR to send a missile directly at it. And since there was only one shot for each unit, the whole plan could be made utterly ineffectual with just a handful of nukes, which, again, were cheaper and easier to produce. But Teller was not so easily deterred. He just resolved to make an even better Excalibur, a super Excalibur, in fact. Designed to be 6 times as powerful as the original, this super ABM would have theoretically been able to zap the entire Russian ICBM fleet in one detonation, provided they were all airborne at once. But again, if it's just sitting there in orbit, it could still be taken out by just one missile. Beyond the theoretical impediments, the project itself was already riddled with problems, and independent reviews of Excalibur's progress were extremely pessimistic. The few test results that showed any kind of success were so sketchy that by the time the reviews were over, many scientists speculated that the laser never actually worked to begin with. By 1986, the project had been relegated to pure research, and only in the field of anti-satellite weaponry. But what about Wallop's lasers? Well, there were some advantages to the chemical laser, mainly in its reusability and the fact that no nuclear bombs were involved, except the ones being zapped, of course.
Chemical lasers fire beams that burn through the shell of the onrushing missile.
But there were concerns about the size of the platform and the cost of the whole apparatus. As mentioned before, this was a big reason for the faith put into the X-ray laser. However, the chemical laser had one thing on its side. It actually kinda worked, demonstrably so even. In 1985, the SDIO tested a deuterium fluoride laser designated mid-infrared chemical laser, or Miracle. Scientists put their Miracle up against an actual ICBM booster at the White Sands testing ground, and the laser actually managed to bring the rocket down. Now, this doesn't mean instant success for Star Wars, because controlled environments are not combat environments, but it was an actual practical result. And it wasn't even the last successful test, as the system would be used later to shoot down test drones, and the program itself would continue until 2006. So, why did it not get put into space? Well, back in the 80s, Miracle was very heavy and expensive to deploy, and a lot of them would be needed to fend off a full-fledged attack. In addition, chemical lasers of the day proved to be quite fuel inefficient, and they were thought to be just as vulnerable to an overwhelming attack as Excalibur was. Okay, so we can't have lasers in space, but maybe we could have lasers on the ground and mirrors in space. Yes, it seems another idea for laser ABM involved relaying beams via mirrors so that the expensive part could remain in friendly territory. This concept actually sort of worked as well during the high-precision tracking experiment in 1985. Super clever name, guys. Scientists bounced a low-power laser off a mirror attached to the Space Shuttle Discovery, and while this was proof of concept, it was deemed more productive in the field of tracking and sensor technology rather than death rays. In the end, it was determined by the SDIO managers that lasers were too Buck Rogers to deploy for ABM purposes anytime soon. There was simply too much research left to be done. But SDI wasn't just about lasers. Even before the Star Wars speech, there were many proponents of kinetic energy weapons, with one of the biggest pushers being an Army general named Daniel Graham. Graham proposed a space-based interceptor system called Smart Rocks. These small, fuel-efficient missiles were meant to hover in low Earth orbit, housed in a satellite garage that would detect ICBMs in their boost phase and intercept before the missiles even breached the atmosphere. ICBMs have three main phases during deployment: the boost phase, the mid-course phase, and the terminal phase. During the boost phase, the missile needs to breach the atmosphere, and that requires a lot of fuel. While boosting, the missile is at its most vulnerable, as the heat plume from launch makes it incredibly easy to track. But this phase is also very short, requiring the ABM system to be close by in order to intercept. In addition, if the missile happens to be a MIRV, the multiple warheads will not have deployed just yet, meaning you could get 4 to 12 warheads for the price of one, depending on the vehicle. Once through the atmosphere, the missile has a brief ascent before entering the mid-course phase, when the launch fuel burns up and the missile begins coasting through space. An ICBM can coast for as long as 20 minutes, providing the longest target windows to still catch the MIRV before deployment. But the problem then becomes detecting and tracking, as there would no longer be a heat plume lighting up the weapon. Nowadays, more advanced radar systems can be used to track mid-course missiles, but back in the 80s, that was more difficult to do. Sometime during the mid-course phase, the MIRVs deploy and the warheads enter their terminal phase. This phase is very short and extremely difficult to defend against. Not only could there be as many as 12 individual warheads, but tracking systems would also have to deal with decoys, chaff, and debris from the MIRV separation. At this point, there are very few options for defense, especially back in the 1980s. All this to say, you could easily see why Smart Rocks would want to hit ICBMs in the boost phase, and Graham was confident it could be done, despite ignoring a plethora of technical problems, but that's just par for the course in this video, it seems. But by the time SDI was created, Smart Rocks was considered too slow to intercept even the relatively archaic liquid-fueled Soviet rockets, much less the super-fast solid-fueled platforms they would soon develop. But in 1986, Graham's Rocks got lucky. All of the directed energy weapon projects were bearing little to no fruit, and the SDIO was desperate to produce a deployable ABM system for the president. So they agreed to move forward with the Smart Rocks concept, which eventually donned the new moniker, Brilliant Pebbles. Teller's Lawrence Livermore Laboratory, now free from the quagmire that was Excalibur, began working on the Brilliant Pebbles project. Firstly, they decided to abandon the satellite garage idea in favor of independent single-missile modules. Originally, each missile would be relatively small, with state-of-the-art sensors and chip processors that, again, did not yet exist. But they knew they would eventually. Anyway, the advantage of having, say, 7,000 or so independent units was that the Soviets couldn't destroy all of them with one missile. Having thousands of them in orbit would guarantee that at least a few hundred would always be above Russia, allowing a boost phase strike at a moment's notice. In addition, each unit was relatively light, which would have allowed for space shuttle delivery by the dozens, or even hundreds per trip. And finally, and most importantly by 1986, the whole project would only cost $10 billion, and considering the original estimate for the laser system, that was actually pretty cheap. But problems soon arose for the Pebbles, starting with loads of redesigns, equipment compromises, and a literally bloating size that started to undermine the ease and portability promised by the project. Now, instead of carrying hundreds of interceptors into space via shuttle, the task was likened to lifting the Titanic from the ocean floor and whisking it into the wild beyond. Oh yeah, and that $10 billion estimate did not take into account the cost of delivery. But hey, how expensive could a shuttle launch actually be?
Ooh, yeah.
And if that wasn't bad enough, just like smart rocks before it, the propulsion used for brilliant pebbles would similarly be unable to intercept solid-fueled rockets, meaning that by the time a cost-effective rollout could be achieved, the system would likely already be obsolete. Despite these setbacks, Brilliant Pebbles would persist as a research program well into the early 90s, before it was finally canceled by the Clinton administration. There were other bold ideas during SDI, including high-velocity railguns. These systems use electromagnetism to attract an inert projectile along rails, building up energy before being launched toward a target at speeds faster than a bullet. But even today, this tech is still being developed.
It's not making a good contact.
The same could be said for particle beams, another form of directed energy weapon that saw testing during the late stages of SDI.
Particle beam weapons with pulsing rays join the attack.
So many of the programs started during Star Wars were solely research-based. And even though none of them brought Reagan's dream of a nukeless tomorrow to reality, some of them did plant seeds that bear fruit even today. So no, there were never American death rays pointed at Russia, nor even space interceptors or orbital defense platforms. The dream of SDI was simply too fantastical to be realized in the 1980s. But perhaps that was never the point at all. Reagan's Star Wars, once a popular humanitarian dream, would see increased criticism during the latter years of the 1980s. The program was bloated, it overpromised and underdelivered, and nothing Reagan appeared to hope for happened during his presidency. Congress continually defunded the project throughout the late 80s, and though it would survive in the hands of Reagan's successor, George H.W. Bush, it would finally see its end in 1993, at the sticky hands of the sax man himself, Bill Clinton. Even today, SDI remains a controversial and confusing topic for political and historical analysts alike. On the surface, it appears to be the most expensive defense debacle of the Cold War, full of big ideas and not-so-big brains, blowing billions of taxpayer dollars on science fiction nonsense. Some say it was a cynical piece of military-industrial pork, proffered by the Reagan administration to line pockets and grease palms. Still others contend that it was a Machiavellian ploy to bankrupt the Soviets during a period of unrest in Russia. There are so many facets and points of view involved that it can be hard to know exactly what to think of Star Wars. What were the actual goals of SDI? Let's take it at face value first. We just talked at length about some of the experiments and research aims of SDI, and what we learned is that almost none of them stood a chance of working in the way that Reagan intended. If SDI is taken for the actual stated goal it hoped to achieve, then it was at least a well-intentioned failure. But many take the view that the government and its military advisors must have been living in a dream world, or that they took a double dose of stupid pills when they dreamed up SDI. Or maybe it was just one airheaded leader that nobody could say no to. It's tough to make a judgment for certain, but the wealth of interviews, memoirs, and first-hand accounts we have to go on indicates that at least the military and scientific communities were under no aspersions about whether or not SDI could ever truly function in its stated purpose. Because of this, there is a prevailing belief, especially amongst anti-Reaganites, that the president was being told what he wanted to hear by his closest advisors, and that nobody wanted to tell him that it couldn't be done. It sounds crazy in hindsight, but SDI could have been Reagan's moon landing, and based on his memoirs and diary entries for the time, he may have even thought of it that way himself. But allowing a multi-billion dollar farce to continue just to save face seems a hard pill to swallow for some, as that would require a substantial amount of impropriety on the part of some of our highest agencies, which would be crazy, of course.
Holy North, Holy North.
And after all, there were other benefits of having SDI around. I mentioned earlier that the Cold War was fought mainly by diplomats, and that foreign ministers on both sides were always on the lookout for better bargaining chips. Well, as it turned out, Star Wars was a very powerful tool for diplomacy, at least for a while. For whatever reason, the Soviets were very nervous about SDI, and they made it a priority in their dealings with Reagan to try and curtail progress on space-based weapons. At multiple summits, Gorbachev attempted to dissuade Reagan from pursuing SDI, and many in the US diplomatic community felt they had a veritable trump card in dealing with the Russians. And even though Reagan refused to negotiate the scale of SDI, he wasn't above using Star Wars to put Gorbachev on edge during meetings. Yes, the Soviets were seemingly afraid of SDI, but it is a bit confusing to ponder why that might have been. They almost certainly didn't think it could actually be done, as they had pursued similar goals earlier and came to the same conclusions. It is speculated, though, that their real fear was that the US was using SDI as a pretense to put nukes in space, aimed at Russia. And this would be a compelling reason, only we have no way of knowing if that was the truth. Perhaps the Russians simply feared what billions of dollars worth of research into space-based weapons might churn up. Even if it was far-fetched, there was always the off chance it might work. It certainly would have been hard for them to believe that America was blowing through billions for nothing. What we do know is that eventually, just like the rest of the world by 2020, the Russians stopped caring about Star Wars. During the Washington summit in 1987, Reagan and Gorbachev were discussing the ABM treaty as it pertained to SDI, and the Future START treaty that aimed to further limit nuclear arms. Reagan had prepared to do battle over SDI, making an unequivocal statement that the US would deploy any space-based countermeasures as soon as they possibly could. But rather than argue about it, Gorbachev basically said, "Do what you gotta do." Reagan certainly hadn't expected that kind of casual response from the premier that had twice made SDI a major point of contention during summits. The spell of Star Wars had been broken, and it quickly ceased to be a bargaining chip for the US. Much of the credit for this change in the wind is given to Andrei Sakharov, the father of the Russian hydrogen bomb. Gorbachev had recently freed him from exile, and Sakharov quickly set to work criticizing the policies of both Russia and the US. In particular, he chided the Soviets for giving any kind of credence to SDI, calling the whole idea a Maginot Line in space, a huge, expensive spectacle that would never meaningfully affect nuclear conflict. If SDI's goal was to bully the Soviets at the negotiating table, the program's own incompetence would ruin that prospect after only 4 years. Quite a price to pay for a bargaining chip that was never fully used. Speaking of prices, what about that massive price tag? It is estimated that SDI ended up costing the American people at least $30 billion, and to some, that is the true reason for Star Wars, to get money. I mean the defense program, of course. And make no mistake, a whole bunch of contractors got a whole bunch of money to make the even minuscule progress SDI made happen. Now, it might seem unfair to level that criticism when every defense program ends up giving money to private government contractors, but it is definitely something to consider. Reagan did like to put money in the defense budget, though, and claiming SDI was only about money seems a stretch when he had already secured enormous sections of the national budget for the military. But the old adage still carries weight, and if any of you out there have the stomach to follow the money, I'm sure you'll find somebody getting paid when they probably shouldn't have. So if SDI was not a sincere effort, and it wasn't a diplomatic cudgel, and it wasn't a cash grab, any more than any other government program, I mean, then what was it? Well, there is an old theory that has gained some credence over the years, one that would neatly button up the whole crazy mess and explain away all of the exotic nonsense of the Star Wars saga. What if the whole point of SDI was to bait the Soviets to respond and force their already suffering economy into a depression? It's brilliant, right? It would mean that the whole rigmarole was for show, and that they only did it to trick Russia into building space lasers of their own, or at least to build more nukes that they knew they couldn't afford. Pumping SDI full of money would only serve to force the Soviets to act with more urgency, and in the meantime, diplomats could make all of the promises and threats they wanted on the back of their science fiction red herring. The Russians would have to pour their own resources into defense technology. They couldn't allow a space laser gap to form, after all.
Mr. President, we must not allow a mineshaft gap!
It explains everything. Reagan did it all for show, with his pulsing intellect tearing down the Iron Curtain with ruthless resolve, selflessly sacrificing his own image to finally crush communism forever. Sorry. Yes, this has been a popular theory in Reaganite circles, but it certainly isn't new. In fact, the Russians suspected this ploy almost from the beginning, with Carl Sagan expressing that sentiment on behalf of his own Russian colleagues.
The pie is too crumbly, crumbly.
And yeah, it could be partially true, but there are lots of problems with this big brain paradigm. Firstly, it's not at all what Reagan said in public, private, or even in his own diaries. And before you say anything, I know all of that could have been washed and altered, but as far as first-hand accounts go, I know of only one anonymous report that mentions the bankrupt the USSR angle. Secondly, even if Reagan was kept out of the loop and the deep state cabal was behind it, it's not like the Russians were even attempting to keep up with SDI. I mentioned earlier that they tested lasers and space-based ABM before the US, but they rightly figured it wasn't worth the money. And yes, if SDI had been successful, the Soviets would have had to respond, but Sakharov rightly assessed the vulnerability of space-based weapons as early as 1986. If the USA put lasers in space, the Soviets could have countered them for merely 10% of the price paid to put them there. In hindsight, we know that the fall of the Soviet Union was a multifaceted and complex series of events involving politics, military issues like their recent failure in Afghanistan, and yes, economic issues as well. But the Soviet economy was showing signs of stagnation even before Reagan's election. And while they did end up spending more on their military during the 80s, that was more a response to the Reagan administration's rhetoric and foreign policy. And it started even before SDI was announced.
The new American president is an ignorant fanatic who wants to wipe us off the face of the earth.
Did Reagan intend to put strain on the Russian economy through his no-nonsense, tough-on-commies image and lavish defense spending? Maybe. But to say Star Wars was tailor-made for that purpose seems a bridge too far for many. Whatever the case, we know the Russians certainly did not see it that way. In the end, I imagine the true goal of SDI was some amalgamation of all of the aforementioned factors. One extremely ambitious program that could scare the Russians, progress defense research, put pressure on the fragile Soviet economy, and maybe even build a laser or two to defend America.
What if free people could live secure in the knowledge that their security did not rest upon the threat of instant U.S. retaliation to deter a Soviet attack, that we could intercept and destroy strategic ballistic missiles before they reached our own soil or that of our allies? I know this is a formidable technical task, one that may not be accomplished before the end of this century.
If you made it this far, thank you so much. This video was one of the biggest, most interesting topics I've researched yet, and there is so much more that could have been said about it. Every angle I examined could have been a video in itself, and I hope my offering here gave you some level of understanding of this really wacky subject. I know it's different from my normal fare, and I do plan on doing another Broken Arrow next, but I hope to be able to produce more esoteric essays like this one in the future. So let me know what you thought, and if you'd like to see more. And, you know, like and subscribe. Thanks.